By way of announcement, I'd like to share today's peace moment. It is such a peaceful scene, Deb Crowley writes, when inches of white, fluffy, freshly fallen snow covers the ground. Trees, bushes, houses, and all else outdoors. It is especially lovely when the sun shines through and everything sparkles anew. It's less peaceful for those who have to plow it, scrape cars, or drive any distance. Even less comfortable for our friends without addresses that live in tents along the rivers or under bridges, and for those living in houses with little to no heat. The weather isn't something we can control. We simply have to cope. We can choose our attitude towards it by seeing the beauty in the wintry scenes, and perhaps we can bring a little peace into the world for those who find it difficult to find beauty in their life circumstances. We can work to end homelessness, provide sleeping bags or tents or propane heaters to organizations that distribute them to clients without roofs over their head. We can offer support to agencies and the Oblation Fund that help pay for fuel to heat homes. We all must engage in venues where we can bring a little sunshine to the world and together build the kingdom of peace. So thanks to Deb Crowley for that, and we'll now begin our prelude.
Good morning. I would like to welcome you this morning by saying my vow in my Ojibwe Lation. Wuzu Giji Manadu. Wuzu Nindawe Maganaduk. Nagamud Vaneshi Indishnikos. Sagana Akin Indunjaba. Makwa Indodame. Gagage Anishinaabe Indao. Pama Daisy Win, Pama Daisy Win. Jimmy Gwich, Jimmy Gwich. Aho. As I welcome you in my Ojibwe language, I will share with you what we have said this morning. Wuzu is our word for welcome, and I am welcoming Giji Manitou, the creator, and Nindawe Maganaduk, all my relations, which is each one of you, because we come from the one God that has created us all. I am from the Saginaw Chippewa Indian Tribe of Michigan, and I am a Bear Clan member. Bear Clan people in my tribe are the ones who are the protectors or the people who take care of others. I am proud to be an Ojibwe woman. I am proud of my status to be able to share as a mother in our tribe. I believe in the everlasting life, and I repeated that twice because when we want to emphasize something, we say it two times. And lastly, I said, I thank you with big thank yous. And again, I repeated Miigwech, Jimmy Gwich, meaning big thank yous. Aho is sort of like the word amen. It means so be it. My English name is Dee White Eye, but some of you may know me by other names. I was born and raised in Flint, Michigan, and I came to Graceland in 1971 for my freshman year as Dee Denman. But I have lived across this country in 8 different states and across the border in Ontario, Canada. And even within those states and places, I've lived several different locations. But wherever I went, my main priority was to find where our church was located and go to the Community of Christ congregation closest to me and be an active participant. I also participated in Indian ministries within the church for the past 45 years. And some of you may know me because at world conferences, I led the singing or I participated in those worship services that we had for Indian ministries. Or perhaps you were at the dedication of the temple in 1993, and there was this young Indian girl who sang an honor song in her white buckskin. That was me. You may also know me because I came back to Graceland my second time as Dee Worthington in 1984, and we lived here for 4 years as I did admissions for Graceland, and I also worked for the Department of Human Services. So this time I'm returning to the Hill to retire. I'm going to finish my career as a therapist at Graceland University, and I've bought a little home in Lamoni, so I plan to stay. As of January, I have joined Rich Higdon and Stu Sherman in the pastorate, and I will be serving all of my people here in Lamoni. So that's a little bit about me. You may have thought you don't know me, but maybe now you do. And if you still don't know me, well, today is our first day to get to know each other. Please join me as we share in the good spirit of our Creator. The call to worship today is a responsive reading, and my sister Becky Willa Chance, and myself will be doing the reading. And you can see there, we have the leader and the congregation. Becky's going to do the congregational part, and you may join her, muted of course, but sing, say those words along with her, if you would. For God alone, my soul waits in silence.
I wait in silence with hope.
God alone is my rock.
God is the rock of my salvation. I shall not be shaken.
Trust in God.
God is my refuge.
For God alone, my soul waits in silence.
I wait in silence with hope.
Thank you, Becky. Our opening prayer of gratitude and blessing will be by Luetta Clothier, and there will be a prayer response after her prayer. Lou?
You've probably been hurrying around this morning, getting yourselves and your family ready for this worship service. So before we pray together, let's take just a few moments of silence to center ourselves in God and to open our hearts to His blessings. We are so grateful, O God, to be together with each other and with you. You who are as near as our own breathing. We sense that you are waiting here for us, waiting to bless us this hour, waiting to reassure us, waiting to fill us, and we're so grateful. We recognize you as the source of all life, the incredible variety of your creation. In the chaos and in the uncertainty of this pandemic, we find stability and faithfulness in the cycle of nature, the unfailing rising and setting of the sun and the moon, the spring's flowers following after winter's resting. Bless us to be aware of the miracles around us everywhere, and as a result, to live lives each day, lives of gratitude. The road of this pandemic has been so long. Yet even in these difficult months of sacrifice and isolation, there have been blessings beyond measure. As we have prayed each day, grant us courage to risk something new. You have taught us new ways of doing family, new ways of doing church, new ways of connecting, though we are scattered. And yes, new reasons to laugh and sing. And we're so grateful. Our thoughts turn to our country. In recent weeks, our television screens have shown us smoke of violence and smoke of celebration, fireworks and joy. Oh God, please, please bless our new president and all of our leaders in the serious challenges ahead. And we have to say we're just so grateful for each other, friends and family who support us and whose lives inspire us, people who share our love for Jesus Christ and for this wonderful community of Christ. Give them the assurance that there is nothing, absolutely nothing in all creation that can separate them from the love of God through Christ Jesus. We thank you now for this precious time together. And in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, we place this hour in your hands. Amen.
Hear our prayer, O Lord. Hear our prayer, O Lord. Incline your ear to us and grant us your peace.
Thank you, Sister Lou. And now we have a guided meditation. And now we have a guided meditation by Ben Easter.
Okay, I'd like to ask you all at this time to assume a comfortable position with your feet on the floor and in an upright posture. Focus on deep, relaxed breaths. Rest your hands on your lap or in another comfortable position. Pay attention to your breathing and clear your mind. Listen to the words of guided meditation. Forgive me. Forgive me, O God. At times I am distant. For poor choices, your mercy I seek. At times I am distant. Forgive me, O God. Forgive me.
Thank you, Sister Benna. Our scripture reading will be by Rich Higdon.
Listen to the voice that echoes across the eons of time, and yet speaks anew in this moment. Listen to the voice, for it cannot be stilled, and it calls you once again to the great and marvelous work of building the peaceable kingdom, even Zion, on behalf of the one whose name you claim.
Thank you, Brother Rich. Can everyone please join with us as we sing the hymn of calling? It would have been 578 in your hymnal, but we're going to have the words right up here. And it's Jesus is calling.
Service he needs, calling for.
yes, he is definitely calling us. Our prayer for peace this morning will be by Becky Willis Schantz. Becky?
Good morning. This week, we have witnessed and experienced major historical events after an especially tumultuous year. Let's take a moment to reflect and offer collective prayers for peace. I share these words written this week by a Canadian friend of mine, Barb Kernahan, who lives near Toronto, Ontario, Canada, as part of my prayer for peace today. Creator of all that is good, one who loves all people and created them in your image, today I come asking for your protection upon the U.S. leadership that is about to lead the country anew. May wisdom prevail. May love be the focus of all who will serve. May they remember that everyone born is a person of worth, and may the spirit of unity become a reality. May walls be torn down and bridges become the norm. May all put aside what divides and build upon what is good and worthwhile. O Lord, all people need good health and jobs. All need access to basic needs for food on the table, a roof over their heads, and safety for their families. All need the opportunities for good health care so physical bodies can heal. Children of all ages need to be heard and listened to, plus given opportunities for education. May your light shine brighter and brighter as a new era comes into play. Hear my prayer, O Lord, that kindness and goodwill will take place in the hearts and minds of our neighbors to the south. So today, I focus on the USA while I remember I wish the same for all the people of the world. Amen.
Thank you, Sister Becky. Mark Hensley, are you here?
Yes.
Oh, good, good. Brother Mark is going to do the Disciples' Generous Response now.
I'm going to read to you this morning a scripture that we're very familiar with from John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. So we have the words right there, God so loved the world. And do you feel that this morning, the gratitude of what he has given us? The deep and abiding love of God is ours. For God has created the world and he has gifted us with his Son, Jesus Christ, our companion and our teacher and our friend. Are we grateful? Are we grateful to God for this? And so this morning, you can unmute yourselves for a short season and share if you have something that you're particularly grateful for this morning. Would anybody like to share something that you're grateful for?
Beauty of the snow.
Thank you.
The opportunity to be.
My first grandchild, healthy and whole.
Great.
For health.
Joy and employment.
For these services.
For my neighbors.
Thank you all. I was sharing earlier in Sunday school class that during 2020, I found myself to be a more grateful person because you think about all that's going wrong and all the negative things, but I just naturally kind of gravitated towards being grateful for little things that I focused on. And I think the reason I did that just kind of naturally is that it's hard to be downtrodden at the same time you're grateful. It's like taking a candle into a dark place. The two can't exist at the same time. And so I thank 2020 that I'm a more grateful person than I have been in the past. David writes in Psalm 24:1, "The earth is the Lord's and everything in it, the world and its inhabitants too." So you see, it all belongs to God. And James 1:17 echoes this truth. Every good gift, every perfect gift comes from above. And these gifts come down from the Father. So once we really believe that all things we have ultimately belong to God, we can go forward with the practice of giving back to God. He gives us blessings, and we give him back blessings of time and substance because we want to be more like him. I have a modern day parable for you. It's a story, once upon a time story. There was a man who had nothing. And so God gave him 10 apples. The first three apples were for the man to eat. The second three were for him to trade for shelter. And the last three be traded for clothing. And so God gave him the 10th apple so that he would have something to give back to God in gratitude for the other nine. So the man did just that. He ate the first three and he traded the others for shelter and clothes. And then he looked really hard at that 10th apple, knowing that God wanted him to give it back with a grateful heart. But this last apple seemed so much bigger and redder and juicier than the other nine. And the man reasoned that God already had all the apples in the world anyway. So why would God need this apple? So the man ate the 10th apple and gave the core to God. Did this man understand God's love? We should not give because we think God needs our gifts in order to be God, or the church needs our money in order to be the church. The people of God, that's you and me, give to the church and to God because of our gratitude for him. It's a way of letting him know how much we appreciate what he has given us. So we give back to God what is God's, so that through our gifts, the love of God can be a tangible reality in our world. Our giving is a reminder of the blessings God gives us and gave to us through Jesus Christ. It's a way to say thank you to our Heavenly Father. I think 2020 has caused us to maybe, many of us, as I was calling people and checking in on people yesterday, there are many of us that have not given regularly to the church during 2020 because we haven't been in the building. One of the ways to help that is through e-tithing. But if you're like me and you want to play catch up, try to focus more on that giving. People have asked, how do I do that? Well, you can e-tithe, you can also give it to the person who's the head of stewardship in your congregation. You can drop it off in their house. You can mail it to them. You can, those are the two main things that I can think of. But if we just can kind of think about that a little bit more, be a little bit more in the sense of gratitude for all that God has given us and give back to him what he asks. Shall we pray briefly for the funds that we're going to give? Lord, we pray that we will have the intense interest in giving back to you, and that you will multiply and make the funds that we give to you greater than they naturally would be for the causes of the building of the kingdom. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, your Son and our Savior. Amen.
Thank you, Brother Mark. The morning message today will be by Rich Higdon. The kingdom has come near. Rich?
Thank you, Dee. It's good to see so many pictures up on Zoom this morning. I thought I would never give a sit-down sermon, but here I am. I'll let you decide if I bothered to put on pants this morning. I'm sure we'd all rather be in fellowship together, but this is the next best thing. It will be just a few more months until we can get the vaccine and resume a normal worship experience. However, we may want to use this opportunity of starting church in person again to re-examine how we worship and the goals of that worship. We have an important topic to think about this morning, and I think in some ways it's central to who we are as Christians and who we are as Community of Christ members. I've learned a lot doing research for our topic, and it has enriched my understanding of the kingdom. I trust with the Spirit attending our gathering this morning, we can truly have the kingdom come closer. Now, at this point, I'm going to pause a few seconds and trouble you to get a piece of paper and a pen. So everyone scurry around and get a piece of paper and pen, because we're going to write down a few words. Okay, it looks like a lot of people have accomplished that. I've got two Greek terms that will be helpful for you to jot down so we can continually refer to the differences in the two words. Distinguishing between these Greek words is critical to our discussion this morning. We might as well get those definitions on paper now before we look at the scripture. When we read the word time, you and I think of what the Greek word chronos, chronos, means. Chronos means a particular point in time, a date on a calendar, an hour in the day. However, the writer of Mark didn't use the word chronos. He used the word kairos, K-A-I-R-O-S. It's not a mistranslation, because both words translate into English as time. However, kairos has more to do with the eternal quality inherent in any given moment. I'll say that again. The eternal quality inherent in any given moment, kairos. Kairos also has to do with the right time, the opportunity, conversion, transformation, the right time for an action. Please write some of those words down so you can kind of refer back to it. Now, because the idea is not easy for us to grasp, let's take a moment and think about what that means. The eternal quality inherent in any given moment. If you're struggling with that idea, as I have, don't worry. We'll explore it in greater detail as we continue this morning. The focus scripture passage for this morning is Mark 1, 14 through 20. But I'm going to shorten that a little bit. If you have a Bible there, open it to Mark 1, 14 and 15. Now, after John was put in prison, Jesus came unto Galilee, preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God, and saying, the time, kairos, is fulfilled, and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent ye and believe the gospel. I'll admit that I always read that word time in that scripture using the Greek word chronos, a point in time. If we use the definition of chronos, we are left with two troubling conclusions, however. First, Jesus was wrong that the kingdom is at hand, because the kingdom has clearly not arrived after 2,000 years, because we see so much suffering and wrong in our world. The second potential problem with the scripture, if we use the word chronos definition of the word time, could be the authors of Mark put words in Jesus's mouth or misquoted Jesus. I think most of us in the community of Christ Church have defined time as chronos in this scripture. I know I have. We easily take the position that Jesus was quoted accurately and Jesus was correct. Jesus was correct that the kingdom is near, but we just can't fully see it and realize the kingdom is near. This usually isn't a problem, because the idea that the kingdom is near is comforting to us. As we will discuss later, in many ways, the idea that the kingdom of near continues to be a central principle of the community of Christ. For me, and I trust many of you, Zion is the kingdom of God on earth and is what Jesus refers to in this scripture. Now, I hope most of you are sitting down, because I'm going to go out on a limb and make a bold statement. But before I do that, as I alluded to earlier, let me say that because we as Community of Christ members have been brought up believing that the establishment of Zion as God's kingdom on earth is what Jesus is talking about. And when he says kingdom of God is at hand, Jesus was right when he said it. And we are right believing that is God's intention for earth and our critical mission as a church. But before you hurt yourself patting yourself on the back, here's my bold statement. If we just believe that Jesus is saying that the kingdom of God is at hand refers to Zion, we are also missing an important meaning in Jesus' statement. Let me say that again. If we just believe that Jesus is saying that the kingdom of God is at hand refers to Zion, we are also missing an important meaning in Jesus' statement. Before we dive into that bold statement, however, I need to talk about one aspect of scripture as a general principle. Some scriptures clearly lead us to practice the sacraments and ordinances. Of course, those practices are wonderful and indispensable, because we can perform physical actions that are heavenly designed to bring us closer to the kingdom and to the divine. The scriptures that do that are critical for our spiritual journey, because we are physically oriented beings: smell, taste, sight, hearing. However, I would say that the majority of scripture leads us to understand the spiritual nature of God. These scriptures don't mandate specific action, but challenge us to think and explore the divine nature of our Creator. These scriptures can't mandate certain actions, because in doing so would destroy the spiritual nature of God, and indeed the spiritual nature of God's kingdom. The scripture we're discussing this morning is one of those scriptures that can be viewed from several angles, and each unique view is beautiful in that it calls us into an ever-deepening relationship with the divine. And guess what? Said differently, brings us closer to the kingdom of God. So let's get back to my earlier bold statement that if we just believe that Jesus is saying that the kingdom of God is at hand refers to Zion, we are also missing an important meaning in Jesus' statement. When we change the word chronos to kairos, a whole new meaning appears. And then Jesus gives us a clue in the form of a commandment of what that means. Please note that Jesus' proclamation of the kingdom is at hand comes as both a gift, which is the good news, but then it comes with a demand. And that demand is for us to repent. And therein lies the clue of how you and I can enter into the kingdom of God. You must repent. Of course, now we need to have a discussion about what it means to repent. Of course, many of us immediately consider the act of repentance as being sorry for our past sins, feeling anguish over those sins, asking forgiveness, forgiving ourselves, and feeling God's forgiveness. You're not wrong to include those steps in your repentance experience, but there's another element to repentance that is often overlooked. As an aside, and kind of to illustrate my point, my sense of humor has been accused of being a little odd, but there's a funny movie from the late 70s named Monty Python and the Search for the Holy Grail. I'm not sure I'll recommend the movie to anyone, but because there's some questionable scenes in it, and it's British humor, which is a tad odd anyway. But there's a funny scene where King Arthur and his knights are riding around England, and a cloud opens up, and it's God. Immediately, King Arthur and the knights get on their knees. God looks at them and asks what they're doing. King Arthur says, well, we're kneeling in respect, or something along that line. God snaps back at them and says, every time I want to talk to someone, it's always sorry this and forgive me that, and I'm not worthy. It's quite annoying. In that spirit, I want to put a little different understanding of repentance. The element of repentance that is often overlooked is the opening of the mind to appreciate different positions. This new position or thinking comes from reading, study, thought, discussion, and prayer. We live in a world of magnificent resources at our fingertips, and we can learn so much so easily. That too is part of repentance. And if we learn different paths of action, I think it can keep us from making the same mistake over again. So Jesus clearly gives the demand for repentance to enter the kingdom of God. There are no other requirements. There is no amount of money that will get you there. There's no amount of education that can get you there. There are no amount of good deeds that can earn your way to the kingdom. Luck doesn't enter into seeing the kingdom. Jesus is quite clear. Only through repentance can you enter into the kingdom of God. That's the central point of my remarks this morning. Only through repentance can you enter into the kingdom of God. Now, finally, saints, in our scripture this morning, Jesus conveys a sense of urgency. And I suspect that that urgency comes from Jesus wanting to have everyone experience the kingdom coming close as soon as possible. But also, Jesus realizes mankind only has a short window of life to experience that kingdom. And he wants all to share in that kingdom. I hope my thoughts this morning have has caused you to see Jesus's phrase, "The kingdom is at hand," in a different light. Using the word kairos adds meaning that is both beautiful and exciting, because the promise is made to every person forever. The promise that the kingdom is at hand is as true today as it was when Jesus said it. You and I can become part of that kingdom by trusting in Jesus' words and repenting. And I think all of us have felt those moments in life, perhaps at death, perhaps at a birth, perhaps some other moment where that kingdom has come very close to us. And those, and the reliving and the refeeling of that experience may be one of the reasons that you are here this morning. Join me in that kingdom. Amen.
Thank you, Brother Rich, for sharing your thoughts with us today. We would all join now in the hymn of response. In our hymnal, this would be 586, The Summons. Such a meaningful song. Our responsive reading is Jesus Proclaims the Kingdom, and it will be led today by Mark Easter, and Luetta Clothier will be representing the congregation. You may join in with her as we do this reading. Go ahead, Mark.
Jonah went to Nineveh according to the word of the Lord.
The kingdom has come near.
Peter became a fisher of people in response to the call of Jesus.
The kingdom has come near.
Paul taught that the present form of the world was passing away to give to the kingdom of God.
The kingdom has come near.
Search for divine purpose that is in the struggles, as well as the joys of diversity. So must it always be in the peaceable kingdom.
The kingdom has come near.
Dee, you're still muted.
Thank you. The hymn of commitment is I Have Called You By Your Name, and it's number 636. Please join in with us in singing this. Closing benediction. I want to thank you, Stu, for sharing ahead of time. And please remain silent as we listen to the prayer response. Stu?
Lord, as we leave our virtual sanctuary this morning, we are reminded. Reminded that our knowledge is finite, and yet the kingdom has come near. Reminded that our feelings are in many ways measured, that our joys are often shallow, and yet the kingdom has come near. Reminded that we allow our time to be spent less productive than might have been. Reminded that we sometimes allow our thoughts to be distracted from our core values, and yet the kingdom has come near. We know that you reach for us, each of us, with outstretched arms. We know that you wait patiently for us to gain knowledge and understanding, to feel deeply, to focus our thoughts, our time, our very being. rightly in step with your vision. We wish as a group to be an increasingly useful vehicle, drawing ourselves and our world ever closer to that kingdom. To that end, and in the spirit of that notion, we emerge from our fellowship this morning secure in your love for us and ready to engage wherever you have need, we pray. Amen.
And so my precious people, they are mine.
I want to thank you for joining us today. And you are all invited to come into the virtual lobby after our service now. I'm going to turn it over to our Mission Center President, Glenn Johnson.